So for anyone who doesn't know who this is, it's Malcolm King, who I've been lucky enough to meet. How many months? This year, isn't it? Pretty much.
Within the year.
Yeah, within the year. Which has been pretty surreal for me. I think the first time actually...
Through George.
Yeah. And yeah, me and George going out for a run, he goes, oh, Malcolm's going to come as well. And I remember holy crap.
Did you?
I'm so out of my league. I've had that moment a few times now, where it's been that run with you. There's also a group ride I went out with George on.
Oh, yeah.
And then I got talking to the others on the group ride. And of course, there was George and Sophie. There were some Olympians. Toby Cunn of Steel, who's a phenomenal rower.
Yeah.
So I'm out cruising with these guys and realised how did this even happen? But same thing with running with you guys. I think there was a moment about half an hour into that run. I just looked over it. And I'd been used to training with George for a while. But I looked over at you and I'm just like...
I shouldn't be here, mate.
How did I get to this point? And that's happened to me a lot of times. And I wrote the other thing I wrote the other day after the Rotorua Marathon is how far I've come in 2 years. And for me, there's been a lot of fear and anxiety in training sessions and stuff I've gone to, especially with me with my swimming, because I have a bit of a fear of water and things like that. So me getting into the pool and actually doing training sessions has been really, really scary. I've had quite a few freak out moments and stuff like that. And even for me, I kind of, this is me as a very amateur sports person. And I've even kind of had thoughts of you see yourself and a lot of other sports people out there and you just look so natural out there that...
That's what I think. I think the exact same thing.
Yeah.
I see the pros.
Yeah. But for me as well, some of the conversations that me and you have had, especially with you this year, stepping up from the age groupers to the elites, and even going back further than that, because you've always been a sporty person, haven't you?
Yeah. So, I did swimming, from a really young age, so from when I was about five, my parents got me into it. And just because we owned a beach house and they wanted us to learn how to swim, which is smart. And then we just started swimming competitively, when we started going to school, and I kept swimming right up to national level, and then, come to the finals there, but never podiumed or anything. Kind of stopped when I was 16 or 17. And then just did Huntley triathlons, weightlifting triathlons, stuff like that throughout my school years. And then when I was about 20, my mate, do you know Lewis Tasker?
Nah.
Yeah, he helped me up to do a triathlon, and I've been thinking about it anyway. So that he really sort of got me into it. And that was a 10-man triathlon. And then I saw Graham McGrady, who smashed it that year, beat me by half an hour.
Yeah. I've only met Graham through you in the last probably six to 8 weeks, last couple of months.
Yeah.
He is the most genuine, amazing guy. And same thing, I'd seen some of his Stravas with you at some of the rides and stuff he did, and I'm just Google a little bit, and I'm like, this guy's an absolute machine. But then talking to him, he's been amazing. He just messes with me quite regularly now, and he's just like, how's your training going? He's messaged me before Rotorua, and
he's called
go hard, man, go hard, and super humble, and even with this journey so far, getting into triathlon, I've definitely chosen the right, there's such a camaraderie, and they're all looking out for each other.
I think everybody, when you hear about them, their name, or you see them, you think they're untouchable, and they're not even human almost.
Yeah.
I don't know, you might have even thought about some of the people that you're now mates with. And then you just talk to them and they're a normal person, you're what the heck?
And I know that
you're so
still
scared
this.
To talk to them.
Yeah. And I don't know if it's because with triathlon it's not as highly in the media as what rugby level and things like that is.
Yeah.
Slightly more like that, or because this
triathlon's awesome. It's just three different sports you can do. You can always do a race. So many people, all the cyclists, all the runners, all the swimmers, you just know so many people and get to know people and connections, and there's never a weekend really where there's not a race that you can do. That's what's cool about triathlon.
And also I think with a lot of the fears and anxieties I was having behind it, because there's so many genuine people that are doing the sport as well, that's helped me get through a lot of things as well. Like, I can come to you, even though that you're like, you've always been at a high level, but you can go, I know how hard it is to do all three things back to back. And it's a bit of different.
We probably all relate to each other, you know. We've all done our first triathlon, you know, we've all been there. We've all you know, worn shoelaces in transition, and, you know, like, you just, at the beginning, everybody's the same.
Hey, so. I still wear shoelaces now, but that's only because I can do them so fast.
I can legit
do shoelaces faster than, like, as fast as I can do elastic ones. I'm just as fast either way. Personally, I'm just saying.
Okay. We'll have to have a race.
Next vlog
is going to be a race.
But
we'll see.
But even for yourself, so when did you make the decision to go full-time triathlete as well? Like, how? Because you're working for New Zealand Post, weren't you?
So I was working for New Zealand Post. I was a postie. That sort of got me into cycling. Started to really enjoy it. some people there sort of got me into club racing at the Hamilton City Cycling Club in there. And then did that 10-man and just saw some of the really good guys, and I was like that sort of field, like, I wonder, like, they're only human, I wonder how far I can push my own limits, you know. So I guess it's from that first serious one that I did, always been seeing the top guys and just wondering, like, you know, how far could I also push myself, and also I don't want to look back and think maybe I could have, I don't know, done a certain, like, you know, like, maybe I could have got this record or something like that. I don't want to have any regrets, so I was like, well, I'm just gonna do it.
So again, like, with how
people supporting me and stuff, so it's awesome.
But, like, throwing your job, well, it's not so much throwing your job, but, like, just, like, going, hey.
Yeah, it was a pretty big decision. I'm lucky enough that my parents really support me, so, like, if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be able to do it, like, at the beginning and stuff, but with support from family and friends and sponsors and stuff like that, that's how I'm able to do it, but also, I just committed, I was just like, I'm just going to give it a go, otherwise I'll regret it, you know. Yeah. So,
but even you start off as well, like, you talk to some people and they're just like, they think, yeah, some people, you see some people, they kind of think they're flashiest gear and things as well, like, you wouldn't have started off with all the all the gears either, so.
No, started off on the old classic BNG, old road bike. Yeah, still got that somewhere, got way too many bikes. I definitely didn't have all the gears or anything, my T1 and T2, like, my transitions were slower. And I thought I was, like, smashing it, you know. Because I was thinking I'm more competitive and stuff. And, I remember having, like, had my inhaler, had, like, massive towel, like, boxes and stuff, you know, heaps of food, all that sort of thing. So, and you see people now, like, doing the same thing, and you just know that, you know, that's what you do when you first get into it. You don't really know what you're doing. And now it's just shoes, bike, like, helmet, that's it. Yeah.
Oh, seriously, like, when I turned up for the half Ironman in January, like, I had a checklist. I'm just like,
You got through though, man. The amount of times people forget race belts.
Yeah.
Like, you should just, someone should make a business and just go to triathlons with race belts, like, $10 a race belt.
It was pretty, it was pretty gold. With this conversation with you, it's more, I want people to realise that it's not actually that scary, and there's not that much to be scared of. Going back to Rotorua on the weekend, there was people doing that marathon in 2 hours, the top guy was 2 hours 21. The last guy to cross the line was 9 hours 13.
Really?
Yeah. Like, how insane is that? Yeah. Like, there's always people that get hung up that, oh, I'm not fast, or I'm not... So
yeah.
they don't think they should be there doing things. Like, it's the same thing with, like, the half Ironman and the Ironman. Like, the main reason I set a goal to do a full Ironman is, yeah, there's amazing guys there that are doing, like, you know, sub 9 hours. Or, like, what the fuck? Whatever they're doing, like,
yeah.
crazy times. But then there's the guys out there that are out there for, like, the whole 7, 18, up to 18 hours. Because we start
yeah.
at 7 a.m.,
they have to be done by midnight,
and they're out there plotting their whole time.
Oh, I feel sorry for the people.
And that sucks, but, like, it's just nuts. So, I went to prize giving last year for Ironman. There were 2 80-year-old guys that were out there doing it. There was, like, I think an 83-year-old Japanese guy and an 80-year-old New Zealander. And I got in my head, that was the decision when I said I want to do an Ironman, because I'm like...
It's probably Garth,
I think he does like halves, I think. I don't know if he does
yeah.
fulls anymore. But even there, he's amazing. I think he's like
yeah,
half Ironman,
yeah, yeah.
like...
He's like New Zealand icon.
Eh? Yeah. Garth Barfoot,
yeah.
if you haven't Googled him, he's amazing. Like,
yeah.
he just keeps going, that guy. But yeah, like, I was like, what's my excuse to not doing this if there's 80-year-olds that are taking 17
yeah.
and a half to 18 hours doing it? They've got nothing to be afraid of. You just go out there and
yeah,
plot
yeah.
and just do your own thing. Like...
yeah, like, I've never done an Ironman.
Yeah.
And I haven't really, like, I do want to do one eventually, but...
Have you done a half yet or not?
I haven't done a half and probably do one this
season.
Even
I've done a half and you
haven't. yeah.
so currently I'm faster at doing a half Ironman than what
yeah, that's
Malcolm
true. That's true. You heard it here first, right here.
I've been not talking
about
too hard.
Yeah, we're doing the same one. Think about Karapiro. Should we do that one? It's all on. We'll be on the start line.
I'll see you for the first 30 seconds. But that's the other thing. You start, well, it's a bit different for the half and the full line.
Different
and
goals,
like
you know.
Yeah.
So everyone's got the different goals. But,
exactly. And like, but like, yeah, like you're saying, is the support of family and stuff like that. And personally, for me now, the squad I hang out with, the travel on, like, for me now, Team Hardcore, but even like yourself, Sophie, George, you guys are just an extended part of my family now to me.
Yeah.
And like, I'm super stoked that it was actually a sport I actually chose to get into. Because it's just so much, yeah, it's just so awesome that everyone's
yeah.
there supporting each other. And the anxieties and stuff
awesome
I had behind trying to get into it, especially with the swimming side of things, like the running and cycling, I'm happy to go and do that myself for hours. The swimming, because I struggle with that.
So swimming's the hardest part for you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think
for
a lot of people,
what do you
swimming,
find?
Running.
Yeah.
yeah. So I was a competitive swimmer, so it's natural to me, sort of. But now that I'm swimming up to that elite category, from leading age group races out, you know, I'm at the back of an elite race,
yeah.
so it's crazy, man.
Are you scared now? So this is a fear I have. Not that I think I'll ever be in this position, but if I'm ever in first place, that I take a wrong turn. I know this has happened to someone else that me and you both know.
Yeah.
We won't mention names. But have you ever had that fear that you're just like, you're hooning along, and I've seen it happen on like this YouTube videos and marathons and stuff like that, and the guy that's
yeah.
in the lead hangs the wrong turn and goes the wrong way. Like,
well, to be honest, I've actually made quite a few wrong turns in my time, like, and when I have been leading, just gone like wrong way in transition, like
yeah.
stupid things. And there's one thing, if there's one thing you need to do, it's study the course,
yeah.
you know. And it's actually a funny feeling when you're like going into a race and you're like, okay, I could actually be leading this race, I actually need to like think about, you know, study the course, because it could be me.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not necessarily going to be following someone.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I don't know, for me it's... it's currently, yeah. currently for me it's unrealistic fear.
Like, you even see, you know, Rich and Mario, those guys in the Super League, they're like, how many laps do I have? like yelling out, and he's like, one of the best in the world.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
But yeah, like, there's even been a couple of races I've done where I'm in the middle of the pack, of course, but I can't see anybody in front of me. I'm like, man, I hope I can go in the right way.
Yeah.
the race seems pretty still out.
Trail runs,
yeah, yeah.
Just way out in the middle of nowhere. God.
Oh, So, okay, yeah.
We're going off topic.
Hey, it's a fear of mine. Like. So, like, yeah. So how do you, like...
No,
don't worry. No, what were you going to say?
I was just saying, imagine if you were like, or anybody that's like so far behind that they're going the wrong way. It's like...
That could be happening as well. The volunteers have like been waiting so long, they've given up and gone. And
yeah, they just closed down the whole thing and left, and there's no finish line.
Yeah, well, the road, yeah, road is packed up, the finish line's gone, the guys are coming in, and it's let's keep going.
Yeah.
To a second lap of like the road. It's a drive to get to your finish line.
Yeah.
So, yeah, if, like, for me going forward
the
now.
Arches.
That used to be a finish line for me on a regular basis.
It's a finish line for a lot of people, you know. But now I'm like, let's go to the Golden Archer.
Oh, classic. Anyway, better. So if you watch what goal have you got set next? For me now, for trying to get past the anxieties and stuff that I have in place, all the fears and things, there's a few other things that I do to help with that, but goal setting has been a big one for me. And now it's even like mini goals. So the next big one for me is Ironman. I've got a few other little mini goals in between then.
Yeah.
Do you find that helps with having those goals set in place to help with those
things? Yeah, like, I definitely set goals and stuff like that. You got your Mac Jetty goal and then, you know, the smaller ones. And then also I think something that's really important that you kind of forget about is those, you know, looking back at where you came from as well. If you have a day where you're feeling down and stuff, and then you think you're not doing that well, you know, just looking back and seeing actually how far you've come.
Yeah,
that's awesome. So, but yeah, definitely setting goals. Next, just the season coming up. Like, I'm thinking about doing an international one this off season. Just keep me going, and I just want to smash the elite season. Now that I've done one. Elite season, like I know what to expect.
Yeah.
So I can really prep for it properly this time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the New Zealand elite season is where it's at.
I was like, even for me, just like the short time I've known you, it's just like the passion you have for it. It's just awesome. Even for me, and just even seeing how that short period of time I've known you, just how much further you've come through there as well.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, thanks.
Like, for anyone that just happened to be watching this, it's just like, you just got to take a chance on yourself sometimes, and yeah, you can have a lot of fear and anxiety and things behind stuff, but if you don't put yourself out there, what Malcolm was saying is that you have that fear later on in life, that you just never took that chance on yourself.
Yeah, and people understand, like, people love it when you're never going to go.
Yeah.
No one's going to, like, actually laugh at you, you know, like...
Yeah.
Like, they're not doing it, you know?
Well, exactly, like, even now, when I'm out running now, like, there used to be a point when I'd be out running, I'm like, oh, people are looking at me and judging me and stuff like that. Now that I'm actually a reasonably okay-ish runner,
I just gotta get to that point, man.
They're, oh, no, you'll be out running, and you're looking at someone, and you don't know if they're an hour into a run, 2-3 hours into a run.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, I
know. You can't be looking at someone and thinking
that
30-second effort. Oh, exactly. Like, I'm always about giving that person that high five, just that bit of encouragement to keep, you know, I get it as well. And I don't know, making sure you're supporting those around you and things like that has definitely helped me going forward.
Yeah, it's people around you, it's really important.
Yeah.
Family and friends.
Yeah, and then, but also reaching out to us, if you're not involved in one of those groups, getting into that group, as well, like that's probably the hardest thing for me for when I reached out to do the swimming training, because that's the thing that I dread the most.
Yeah,
that was like that first night I turned up swimming training, man. Like,
it was like freaking out,
dude. That was so hard. Even my first triathlon. So my first triathlon was actually 3 weeks.
The Karapiro one
just before Christmas. Yeah. So that was 3 weeks before I was set to do half Ironman, and like I didn't want to do that at all. But Sophie and George talked me into it. I finished the...
Those two, eh?
Yeah, man. They've been, like, amazing.
Dude, you're lucky you did that.
Oh,
like, 3 weeks out,
dude,
you hadn't even swallowed.
I freaked out so hard at that swim. It was, like, I wanted to give up. So, if you haven't... Yeah, for those who don't know...
I remember that post you did.
Oh, man, it was so bad. Because you're 250 metres down, 250 metres back. But, yeah, the first 250 metres, you hop out of the water, then jump back in and swim back and back down. I finished that first 250 metres, I was done. Like, I was finished. I didn't want to go any further. Sophie was standing on the shore.
Yeah.
And
encouraging
me. And, like, she's just like, go, Brett, you can do this, go. And I was just like, that was just, yeah.
And
I wouldn't have finished
just
that first
250 metres. They're like, she's an amazing triathlete.
That's the thing,
yeah.
Like, that's just it. Like, yeah.
I've got
someone that amazingly that's supporting me. Same with my wife. She's freaking amazing. She doesn't even understand it, but yeah, like it's that whole, like I said, that whole family.
Just taking it back though, like I definitely agree with you about like you just kind of got to do it. Like I put myself in the position to, you know, be a full time athlete. Like I didn't have. You know, I'd come up to me and say, hey, like, I'm going to pay for you to, you know, do this, or come, you know, didn't kind of get invited into, like, a squad or anything like that. I kind of just decided, like, I'm going to do it, and then I'm going to push into a league, like, you know, and you just got to actually do it and commit to it.
Yeah.
Because, like, it's not going to happen unless you actually
Exactly. And, like, that's that hardest, is just, so uncomfortable to take that step, but like you're saying, is you don't want to look back and have those regrets further on in your life and stuff either. So,
just go hard.
Yeah, man. So, like, anyone that is watching this, it's just like, just take that step. Like, there's so many supportive people out there, especially within this particular sport. But anything you go and do is just like there's so many like-minded people that are doing that, and they'll accept you. Like, doesn't matter if you're like the slowest swimmer. There's going to be everyone's going to egg you on and just help you get ahead and do it. So, man, we thought this was going to be like 10 minutes long. We've been like speaking for like 20 minutes.
No one's watching it right now.
No one's watching.
If you're watching at this point, comment that you're watching at this point. No comments.
Also, if you're watching this point, Malcolm will sign some memorabilia for you.
You have to comment the magic word bananas. And then we know you're a real fan.
Yeah. Comment bananas, Malcolm will make you a coffee.
Makes a good
coffee.
Give you some free shoes.
no free shoes. Anyway, thanks for sitting down with me, buddy. Like, I love our talks that we have. We have catch ups every now and again. Not really enough, but
you're like super inspiring, so it's cool to see what you're doing, you know. And like just being on your page the other day and there's people asking you questions, like general public, like you don't even know them, and it's like that's really cool that you're speaking to them, you know. People are actually coming to you and knowing and can trust you and that, you know, like you can help them. So
that's probably that's the weirdest thing for me though. Like that's
when I said I'm like a bit Brett like loves that.
I think it's awesome. Like
I love it, you know?
Yeah.
It's awesome.
I said the other day when I started this page, like, it was more, I was putting myself out there just to kind of, to keep off my main page and just share what I was doing. And then, it got a bit crazy when I saw the numbers start kind of
crazy.
But, it's real cool that, and, everyone needs to understand it's like the level I'm at now, that's not what I've always been at. And the same with you, like, the level you're at now, you wouldn't have thought back, because how old are you now?
No, I'm 24.
24 now. Like, even the level that you would have been, you know, 2 to 3 years ago.
Like, massive progress,
you know? But it's all just, there's so much work that goes on behind that. It's just that you've got to start somewhere, and you just can't expect to see results really, really fast either.
Good, like...
Especially for the level you're doing, like, you're not going to... The results that you see now are so minimal in comparison to what you would have seen 4 years ago with the training stuff you did too, so...
Like, I actually remember, I used to play computer games quite a lot, like I was a bit of a gamer for RuneScape. And anyway, like I decided like when I was going to get into fitness, like running a triathlon kind of thing, I was like, okay, I'm going to run down to the Caltex, which is like literally 500 metres down there. And I was like, I'm going to go get some butter and I'm going to come home and make some cookies. So I swear I was sober. It sounds like I'm like stoned or something. Anyway, so I ran down there. It was so hard. And I ran back and I got like, almost got shin splints. Like I was so sore. And it was like 1 kilometer. And now I can, you know, I can run 30k and
yeah.
stuff, you know. But
I remember the first
I was stuffed.
Yeah.
And that was 1k.
Yeah.
With the break at 500 meters. So, yeah, man, like, at the beginning it's hard.
Yeah.
You'll look back and laugh about where you were. Like,
I remember the first time I ran 350 metres. It was from our house down to the fields down by a place where the boys that had their rugby training. So I finished work, I ran, got back home, and I ran 350 metres. And I just got down to the fields.
Nice, man.
And I said to my wife, who was really down there with the boys, I was like, I ran the whole way here! And she was like super excited for me as well. Now I go and run like an hour, and then she's, I run an hour now, and she's like, how far did you run? I'm like, an hour. She's like, oh yeah.
Yeah.
I remember having this conversation with my mate Mike as well. He's just like, he remembers the first time he told his wife he went for like a 2-hour ride. She's like, yeah, that's awesome. And now he goes like a 5-hour ride. She's like, that's nice, can you take the rubbish out?
Yeah.
It's almost the same with that now. I'll be like, I went for an hour ride, and my wife's like, yeah, cool, the dishes are there. Can you use the dishwasher?
Yeah.
Can you take the rubbish out?
Yeah, like I always used to be like, 100k ride or something. And now, like, I don't even talk about it.
Yeah.
But you got to put it on Strava.
Or you stop at 99.9.
99.9, yeah. That's challenging. That's a lot of prep for that.
I'm sure you just stop your freaking clock like I've done in the past and just cycle the other
k. Well, if I was like 98k and then I was like, I'm actually going to make it 99.9, you know, just for prep. Anyway, we should stop this.
We should stop that. But thanks for sitting down with me, buddy.
That's sweet as. Thanks for your support and all that.
Good. Thanks everybody for watching. Hopefully you have made it here. Like Malcolm said, type bananas if you have watched it all the way to the end.
This will be interesting.